All right, can everybody hear me? All right, well, good afternoon and thanks for coming. So first of all, I'd like to start with traditional land acknowledgement. So we're on the ancestral territories of the Osage Nation and the Illinois Confederacy. And this territory was also used by numerous other tribes, including, the Pawnee, Sac and Fox, Dakota, Lakota, Otoe, Missouri, Omaha, Iowa, Quapaw, Chickasaw, Kickapoo, and Wadnasani. And actually, believe it or not, we have corn from a lot of these folks up in the collection. So I'm going to try to cover about 3 points this afternoon. So who am I? Where did I come from? And why am I working with the corn collection? What is the Cutler-Anderson Corn Collection? And why are a bunch of 80-year-old corn cobs important? So hopefully by the end of this presentation, you'll have some idea on some of these things. So I kind of beamed down mysteriously at the garden, kind of midsummer, and started carrying stinky corn cobs around. But I actually have kind of a long history with the garden. I grew up in South St. Louis in the St. Louis Hills area. I actually went to school down the street at what is now Visual and Performing Arts, where they unfortunately had the shooting a while ago. Back in my day, it was called Southwest High School. My mom was a longtime friend of the garden. So I actually was lucky enough to be at the Climatron the first time they turned on the lights to the public. And probably more importantly than that, I was a product of Ken Peck's Saturday morning kids classes that used to be taught in the old museum building. I'm going to be talking about Edgar Anderson and Hugh Cutler. I don't think I ever met Anderson, but I kind of like to think that since he lived in the little gatehouse there by the Saks Museum, I like to think that maybe one day at one of the kids' classes, he kind of wandered by and to kind of check us out and see what we were doing. I do remember one unit on winter botany, trying to identify trees from twigs and things like that. And that was one of the things that Anderson did write an article about late in his career. So we also had a unit on economic botany, so possibly he contributed to that. So, all right, but I was lucky enough to work with Hugh Cutler and Leonard Blake between 1972 and 1977. So Hugh's office was in the old museum building, and the Saks Museum building. And sometime before we put the corn exhibit in, I'd like to talk somebody into letting me up on the second floor, so I can take a peek at his old office. And as I explained to someone before, Leonard Blake was a retired banker who met Cutler one time at a Missouri archaeological meeting and started working with Hugh. And Hugh kind of analyzed the Western corn and Leonard analyzed the Eastern corn. And almost the day he died, Leonard would come into Washington University and work with a lot of the archaeobotanical students over there. This is a picture of Hugh and Marion Cutler down in Bolivia on their wedding anniversary collecting corn. Now, late in her life, Marion developed an allergy to corn. So she kind of had to cut corn out of her diet. And I think it was her way of telling Hugh that enough corn. I think it's time to retire. So Hugh retired in 77. Okay, so the whole time I was working with you, I never actually saw the corn collection as far as I remember. At that point, I think he kind of lost interest in it a little bit. And so I didn't actually run into the corn collection until a couple of years after Cutler retired. I was working on some corn from Belize. And I met up with, I think Leonard introduced me to Robert Byrd, who was a student of Anderson's, who also did a lot of work with corn. And one day Bird brought me over to the garden and showed me the corn collection. And it turned out that the first article I ever actually wrote mentions the corn collection. I was working on some corn from an archaeological site in Arizona, and I found this collection of Papago corn collected in 1914 from kind of west of Tucson, and I used some of the data from this collection in that article that I wrote. And this kind of shows kind of one of the important points about the collection. It kind of shows the diversity in the past is quite a bit different than if you go out and collect corn today. About 40 years later, Hugh Cutler went and collected some Papago corn in almost the same location. This is San Javier de Bach Mission, which is just south of Tucson, Arizona, and Sells is a little bit west. But by the time he got there in 1953, they were just down to, you know, these white flower corns, and they were starting to grow a lot of the Mexican dents, probably for the commercial market back in those days. So we go from, you know, that many different kinds of corn grown by one village to this. And that's one of the kind of the neat features of the corn collection. Yes?
Are we allowed to ask questions?
Sure. Yeah, so I'll show you another picture of dent corns and things, but in a dent corn, which is most of what they grow in the cornfields today out in Illinois and Missouri and Iowa and stuff like that, there's a little dimple in the tip of the kernel. And that's caused by the starches, the hard and soft starches in the kernel. And as the kernel dries out and stuff, it contracts a little bit and produces a little dent. So, yeah. So I've got another picture later kind of comparing some different kinds of corn. So, get on to that. So, what is the corn collection? You know, it's up on the third floor of this building. It consists of over 6,000 ears of corn. It's also vials of teosinte and corn seed. There's documentation, there's herbarium specimens, things like that. And this is Edgar Anderson. I think anytime you show a picture of a corn person, you're supposed to show them looking at corn. And so there are a lot of pictures like that around. And then this is Hugh Cutler, who I worked with, and this is out in an archaeological site in Arizona in 1957. Cutler was one of the people who pioneered flotation for concentrating carbonized plant remains from archaeological sites. And here's an early demonstration of Cutler doing flotation. We have a stray box of archaeological corn up in the collection, and it actually probably comes from this site, which is Point of Pines in Arizona. And actually, just this morning, I got an email from the curator of Arizona State Museum. I wrote to her like 3 months ago saying, would you like this stuff back? And she finally got back and said, yes, we would. And so we'll be in the process of returning a stray back to the rest of the plant remains from Point of Pines where it belongs. Okay, so as I mentioned before, it's on the third floor of this building. And yeah, with a background in archaeology, I kind of use my archaeological skills, and there's some material cultural differences in this part of the collection. So the older part of the collection, there's seven metal half herbarium cases, and then there's five taller cases. Now, the corn collection was here at the garden until about 1980, which is a little bit after Cutler retired. Then it was sent off to the Crop Evolution Lab at University of Illinois up in Urbana. And I'm pretty sure that these cases date from the Illinois period, And they all have different, they have University of Illinois property tags on them and a little bit different stuff. So I think this part was added after it was up in Illinois and before it came back to the garden. This is kind of what the collection in the Euler cases look like. It's a bunch of ears of corn in individual plastic bags. The shorter cases all have wooden drawers. The taller cases all have metal cubby holes. And one of the challenges of working with the collection is that it, sometime in the past, someone threw a bunch of mothballs in with the ears of corn to keep down the insects and stuff like that. So the older short cases corn all has a pretty distinctive mothball smell. And so now we've come up with a way of, you know, sticking in the fume hood on up in the lab on the second floor for about a day, and most of that that naphthalene kind of smell disappears, and then it can be rebagged and tagged and everything. So basically what I'm doing is going through the collection, kind of rebagging the things in archival bags, making sure that every ear has an individual tag, because it's kind of getting to the point where we're starting to kind of show this stuff around, and we want to make sure that the ears can get back with the rest of the collection. And then in the end, I'm entering the data in Tropicos. So we're maybe a quarter to a third of the way going through the collection, getting that data in Tropicos, and I'm photographing, you know, most of the collection so that, you know, anyone who's interested in old corn can find it in Tropicos and look at what we got. And there's some surprises in the collection. I'm never quite sure what I'm going to find when I open up a drawer. So the other day I was looking there, and there's a bunch of obsidian flakes from Teotihuacan just outside of Mexico City. This is a Folger's coffee can full of teosinte kernels. And if you read the initials on the tag, it's J.R.H., which is Jack R. Harlan, who spent a lot of time, you know, studying domesticated plants and looking particularly at wheat domestication. So this is some material that he collected and added to the collection during the time it was up in Illinois. Yeah, he worked with the crop evolution lab quite a bit. And we've also got, Cutler was also very interested in beans, and a student of Anderson's did a monograph on archaeological beans, so we've got some beans. Cutler himself worked a lot with Tom Whitaker, who was a specialist in archaeological cucurbits. So we've got a box that has a whole bunch of squash seeds from Cutler. The other day I opened up a drawer, and in that were about 50 vials of soybeans of all kinds of different colors. So it's a very diverse collection beyond just corn. Yes?
Your top left picture has a copy of
Plants, Man, and Life, yes. Yes, because I'll just mention that. So on the 100th anniversary of Anderson's birth, they published a new edition of Plants, Man, and Life, and which has an introduction by Charles Heiser, who worked on sunflowers, who's another Cutler Anderson student. And I had just found out about that and copied the new foreword by Heiser that day. And so I thought, I'll just put it in the background. It looks good. But Edgar Anderson wrote a very readable but interesting book called Plants, Man, and Life in 1952. And it's kind of his scientific memoir. He kind of talks about the various different things he worked on at different phases of his life, And the corn was actually, I'll show you in another slide, actually something late in his, or actually kind of midway through his career when he started getting interested in corn. And the last chapter is called Adventures in Chaos, and it's on working with corn. Okay, speaking of working, it's a working collection, so it's not just a bunch of nice ears, pretty ears of corn kind of stuck in a drawer, but numerous papers have been published based on this. Here's being a little bit archaeological again. Some of the corns have interesting use wear. They're broken in half, and then some of the kernels are shaved away. And that's because a student of Anderson and Cutler's, Norton Nickerson, did a monograph on cob morphology at one point in time. So I can go through the collection and go, oh, this is one that Nickerson looked at. Yes, sir.
Can you disambiguate ear and cob?
Okay. Yeah, I hear confusion all the time. So an ear is the whole thing with the kernels. The cob is what's left after, you know, if you're eating sweet corn or something, it's what's left after you chew away all the kernels. So both looking at whole ears and looking at the cobs themselves, which is what you get archaeologically, and you usually get pieces of cobs. Each has kind of distinctive bits of information you can tell from it. Yes?
I see the term flint corn all the time. What does it mean?
Okay. It's kind of like dent corn. And I think I'm going to show you a picture in, you know, just a couple of minutes. But flint corn is the hard corn. It's mostly used for hominy or for grinding or parching. I'll show you. The feed corn is usually the dent corn. You can use most of the different kinds of corn in very similar ways. You can even, roast the dent corn when it's very young and eat it like a corn on the cob, which they do in northern Mexico, but they have some varieties that are a little bit sweeter at that stage and a little bit better eating. You can eat flint corn, at the very immature stage, but it's kind of gummy. Actually, a little while ago, I'm going to talk about teosinte, which is a wild relative of corn. A while ago, I made some teosinte tamales just to see what it was like, and it's kind of gummy. it's not particularly pleasant, but so these would be, well, actually this is a flint corn. Usually the kernels of flint corns are smaller and rounder. I think this one was grown out at the Arboretum, actually, from some material that they had collected originally. And it turns out Anderson and his students and stuff were always growing out samples at Shaw Nature Reserve and stuff. So I think these are not really good examples of Longfellow flint. Usually they're quite a bit longer and fuller and stuff like that, but they were okay for what Nickerson was doing. Also kind of related to it being a working collection, when Cutler collected quite a few of these different kinds of corn, he immediately sent samples off to the USDA seed lab up in Ames, Iowa. There's always a very close relationship between him and Anderson. Pioneer hybrid seed, which William Brown was at, who gave his name to the Brown Center and the USDA also. I showed you the picture before of Hugh and Marion collecting corn in Bolivia. When he was doing that, he sent most of his samples to Harvard and Paul Mangelsdorf, and they just kind of kept the stuff around, and they didn't really turn their stuff over to the USDA seed bank until about 1990. And by that time, the stuff was all dead and wouldn't grow. But so most of the stuff that they have from that collection is listed as historic. No viable seed, just kind of historic reference material. Whereas the stuff that Cutler collected much later, 84% of it is, you can still send an order off to the USDA seed bank and get viable seed for a Papago or Hopi or all kinds of different corn and stuff. So a lot of the material that was in the collection was shared with the seed banks. And you'll see a lot of the ears up there that have most of the kernels missing, and those are the ones that they pick the kernels off and send to either Pioneer or to Ames. And this is kind of coverage in the corn by region and stuff, so most of the stuff we have is from southwestern tribes, Mexico, and Peru. I have a fair amount of stuff from Bolivia. We have a little teosinte, which I'll show you pictures of shortly. And one of the challenges of the collection, you know, besides us having stray archaeological stuff, some of the collection kind of went elsewhere. So a lot of Cutler's archaeological samples got sent to Illinois State Museum. For some reason, most of the stuff from, you know, the tribes around here, up in upper Missouri, from Oklahoma and things like that, are now in Illinois State Museum in some drawers over there. So sometime later this spring, I'm going to go over and try to get photographs and get that information into Tropicos. So, yes? Yeah, a lot of that, yeah. So, kind of in the late 40s, 1950s and stuff, the Rockefeller Foundation was funding a lot of corn collection and things like that. And actually, a lot of our Mexican material is from those collections and stuff. So, yeah, the answer to that is yes. This is kind of the time distribution, you know, on the collections. We have stuff going all the way back to about 1907, 1904 is one of our earliest years, and then a lot of material that was collected in the 40s and 50s. Kind of a lot of this was part of the Rockefeller Foundation National Research Council Races of Maize study. But this kind of brings up sort of an intriguing question. When did the corn collection start? You know, we've got some of this older material, but I've gone through a lot of old Missouri Botanical Garden bulletins and, you know, tried to track information about the corn collection. And it wasn't really until about 1940 that Anderson himself got into corn. And I can't find anyone before about 1940 who was, you know, researching corn. So I think a lot of this, I'll go back, a lot of this pre-1940 material, I think Anderson somehow got as donations from other collections. But I haven't been able to pin that down yet. And there's one note in, we have a bunch of ears of corn from the 1915 Panama Pacific International Exhibition in San Francisco from Bolivia. Somehow we wound up with most of the display material from the Bolivian pavilion at the San Francisco World's Fair, basically. And I saw one note from Jim that mentions a lot of that material was added to the collection in 1947. So I want to kind of go through some of the paperwork and really find out when this older material was added to the collection and where it came from. Okay, so back in 1939, corn geneticist named Paul Mangelsdorf and his colleague George Rees published a couple of papers on the origin of maize. And Mangelsdorf, at the time, thought that there was probably an extinct wild corn somewhere in the world. He kind of guessed down in South America that corn was domesticated from, and that this corn was a pod corn. And this is what pod corn looks like. It's a funny mutation of corn where each kernel kind of has its own husk. So these, it has these long limbs, and they got a piece of pod corn there. And there was an alternative hypothesis published about the same time by George Beadle, a Nobel Prize winning geneticist. And back in the 20s, he was looking at maize and teosinte chromosomes and said, they're the same. Corn probably came from teosinte. And then he went on to work with bread molds and fruit flies and won a Nobel Prize in genetics. And after he retired from his most active research career, after being president of the University of Chicago and a few other things like that, went back and studied maize and brought back the teosinte idea. And after a lot of genetic work and things, we now know that very definitely teosinte is the wild ancestor of corn. But anyway, so that's a little bit teosinte and corn. That's kind of what the two plants look like. So in corn, instead of having all these lateral tillers like teosinte does, the plant concentrates all its energy into, one single stalk, usually with one or two big ears of corn, whereas teosinte has a lot of tiny little ears that fall apart as they ripen. And we've got a lot of interesting teosinte corn hybrids up in the collection, and this kind of shows kind of the general sequence of domesticating corn from teosinte. So it starts with individual little fruit cases that look kind of a lot like little gray pebbles. And in one of the mutations, the kernel gets larger and actually emerges from the fruit case. And this kernel is, it's basically a little pointed popcorn kernel. And in another set of mutations, instead of the little teosinte ear falling apart and dispersing its seeds as it ripens, the protocob kind of starts holding together. And you also get a doubling, in a lot of the corn-related grasses and stuff. There's a sterile flower and a fertile flower at each node. And so one of the mutations is restoring fertility to that second flower, and then you start getting a doubling of row numbers. And you go from something like a two-row cob to a four-row cob, and something looks very much like early maize. If you look at some of the earliest corn from either Peru or from Mexico, a lot of these tiny little ears look very much like that ear that I just showed you here. So that's kind of essentially what this what early corn looked like. I mentioned before that, so this is just kind of Anderson's publications by year. And up to 1940, he was concentrating mostly on, I did a lot of work with irises, with tobacco and spiderwort. And he was looking at at closely related species and trying to figure out good ways of telling these closely related species apart and looking at hybrids between the two of them. And then after I think he got intrigued by that paper by Mangelsdorf. And he got a grant in 1940 to go out and collect a lot of trypsicum. And Anderson himself kind of thought, well, maybe teosinte is a hybrid between trypsicum and corn. And so It was kind of Anderson who added that idea to Mangelstorff's idea. And you can't, they have different numbers of chromosome numbers. You can, with a lot of effort, get trypsochome and corn to cross, but the progeny is usually sterile. So it's as far as we know now, trypsochome is not really involved in the evolution of corn at all. But Anderson got this grant, sent Cutler out collecting first trypsochome, and then started collecting teosinte and all kinds of different kinds of corn also. And actually, the until Beadle retired and kind of started looking at corn again and published a really neat little article in the Field Museum Bulletin and stuff like that, where he kind of presents the whole argument and stuff, they were definitely kind of dueling hypotheses. And there's very few, but I mentioned I started out kind of working with Robert Bird a little bit, and when I started working with the corn collection, I got in touch with Bob Yitton, and he's still kind of wondering, how do you get a cob out of teosinte? There's something else going on there. So it's 99% resolved, but there's still questions and arguments and stuff like that. And let's see, going back a little bit, I kind of want to mention that the wild corn idea, even though Mangelsdorff is best known for it, Guy Collins, who worked at the Plant Introduction Center up in Iowa, and Paul Weatherwax, who also put together another corn collection, both said pretty much the wild corn idea as early as 1912. So it wasn't necessarily completely original with Mangelsdorff. So this is what trypsochome looks like, and like I said, they will hybridize, but the offspring are usually sterile. So, and you can't see it too well, but this is the little cob, essentially, of trypsochome, and then it's got a tassel on top of that, and it doesn't break apart as it ripens quite as readily as teosinte does. Okay. Oh. So Anderson and Cutler started collecting corn. They published an early kind of monograph on the races of maize. They're both kind of known for this races of maize idea. And they defined race as a group of related individuals with enough characteristics in common to permit their recognition as a group. And one of Anderson's tools was something he called the inclusive herbarium sheet. If you read Plants, Man, and Life, there's this wonderful quote that says it's, trying to get a corn plant into a herbarium is kind of like stabling a camel in a dog kennel. And so his inclusive herbarium sheet, have pictures of the corn and all kinds of measurements and stuff. And I think they must have driven herbarium curators crazy, because they don't look at all like a standard herbarium sheet. Okay, so one of the things that Anderson and Cutler wanted to do was come up with a more natural classification of corn. And one of the earliest classifications is from Elis Sturtevant. And, we've had some questions about what is dent corn and what is flint corn and things like that. Even if you open up the Wikipedia page on corn today, top paragraph says there are basically five or six types of corn. And this was also all based on, the type of stored starch in the endosperm of the seed, and the popcorns have all this really hard starch there. The reason popcorn pops is because this hard starch traps the steam inside the kernel until it gets superheated, and then it explodes and cooks the starch. The flint corn has a little bit less to that hard starch, more of the soft starch. Flour corn is mostly soft starch. The dents have the hard starch on the outside, soft starch in the middle, and this is the part that shrinks and produces a little dimple. And then instead of storing starch, the sweet corn stores sugars. So that's where the sweet corns come from. And most of the sweet corns, you look at the dry ears, they have very wrinkly kernels, versus the other one have kind of a nice, you know, kind of plump round kernels. And then that's what pod corn looks like. And it's really another type of endosperm, which is called waxy endosperm, which in this, instead of storing food as starches, it stores food as amylopectin. So when you cook it, it produces kind of a sticky corn, kind of like sticky rice or sticky millet, and sticky barley. It's something that folks in East Asia like very much. And I think once corn got to Eastern Asia and stuff, that's where the waxy gene was selected for. And as I mentioned above, these are interesting taxonomic characters, but they're not taxonomic endpoints. You can have a type, or you can have an ear of corn with like three different kind of kernels on it. And you still see that, you know, sometimes these are called subspecies of corn, indentata, indurata, saccharata, things like that. But they're not good proper subspecies. Okay, so let's look at one of our collections, and kind of some of the diversity. So one day I was working with Hugh Cutler, and this gentleman, Campbell Pennington, happened to be visiting. He was a professor down at Southern Illinois University, and they worked together a lot. And Pennington reminded me a lot of the Looney Tunes character, Foghorn Leghorn. He is a very proper Southern gentleman with his kind of, "Oh, say, boy," kind of accent. So this is Pennington running around in the mountains of Chihuahua and in the 50s and 60s. And this is where the Tepehuan area is. So it's in the southern corner of Chihuahua, close to Sonora, Sinaloa, and Durango. The Tepehuan folks are a Pima-speaking tribe down there. And one of the more interesting collections I looked at is Pennington collected corn from 9 different villages in the Tepehuan area. And his collections have some of the most complete information, because he's got local names on these things. He's got individual uses for the different types of corn. That's what this stuff is, although it isn't real easy to see in this slide. But, this gives you, kind of an idea of the diversity of corn that could be grown in in different areas. It's probably a good thing that Cutler and Anderson didn't use this particular collection for developing their races of maize ideas, because a lot of these ears are mixtures of all kinds of different races and stuff. This one is actually a dent corn from further south in Mexico, which the tag says came into the area about 50 years ago. And a lot of these things are kind of intermediate between different races of maize. So this would have been a hard collection to, sort out races of maize from. But, some of the years that I pulled out these are, four of the races of maize from northern Mexico made their way all into the Southwest also. And one of those, the 12-row flowery corn, like this one, this is from Tepehuan, this is from Yuma, the Yuma tribe in Arizona. You can see, and This is all the way up to Cherokee, so Aurora, I did find some real Cherokee corn. We can keep nice happy now. We've got more than just one little bag. But you can see going all the way from Chihuahua into Oklahoma and stuff, you can see a lot of similarities between, you know, what's basically the same kind of corn. And that's, you know, that's what they mean by races and stuff. Types of corn that, you know, share a lot of similar properties. You know, from these, the what Anderson and Cutler described, the Pima Papago corn, by selecting for larger ears and different kernels, colors and stuff, they came up with some of the southwestern flower corns, which, you know, start being grown in the southwest maybe about 1100 AD and persist into modern times. This is what they make the blue corn chips from. And this shows a gradient going from Hopi over to Taos. And as you go from west to east, there, the butts of the ears, the base of the ears, they get fatter, the ears get longer, the row numbers get higher. And the Navajo, who weren't originally, or Diné folks, who weren't originally an agricultural folks, you can kind of tell from this that they probably got their corn from the Rio Grande Pueblos, because it looks very similar to the stuff from San Juan or from Taos. And we have a whole bunch of other different pueblos upstairs. So, but this is kind of enough. And you get the same kind of gradient with the white flower corns. And even though Anderson and Cutler were working mostly based on morphology, things like ear size and shape and ear diameter and plant characteristics and stuff, people since then who've been looking at DNA proper, you know, find out that these relationships hold up. So here's some of the northern Mexican corn, kind of like the stuff from Tepehuan, the southwestern races, and then coming off the southwestern races are the eastern U.S. races. So the, you know, morphology is pretty good indication of what's going on with the genetics. Okay, so as I worked through the collection, I've kind of wondered, well, where else are there corn collections like this? So probably one of the largest corn collections is probably up at the USDA lab up in Iowa. This is a page from, this is actually from one of Cutler's collections from San Javier that I showed you pictures of before. But unfortunately, most of what they show for pictures are just kind of individual kernels. And our collection shows ears. This is one that I, you know, cut and pasted into here. Now, there are a few pictures of whole ears in the USDA corn collection. And actually, a lot of those came from folks coming down from Ames to the garden in about 2003 and taking pictures of our collection and stuff. But you know, I can tell a lot more about corn from looking at this versus this. So that's one of the areas where our collection is special. There is and there was some corn at the Museum of the American Indian out at the Smithsonian. Here's, you know, a collection from Zuni from 1921, but notice on the card, they threw it away. Our collection is still here. This is what our Zuni corn looks like. Yeah, so this is a early collection by Collins. I mentioned Paul Weatherwax, who is another guy who looked at corn. There's, you know, a smaller collection, but a pretty interesting collection at the University of Indiana in the herbarium. University of Indiana herbarium brags that we've got our whole collection scanned already. So, you know, they're talking about their whole herbarium collection. So we're trying to get there. But that's another collection. This is examples of a collection up at the Museum of Anthropology up in Michigan. A friend of mine from archaeology days and stuff is now the curator up there. And so this was material collected by Alfred Whiting out in the 30s from some of the Hopi villages. And this is one of his information gathering sheets and some of the purple corn. So there is some of the, I don't think we have anything from Whiting, but we have some from Catherine Bartlett, who was collecting from Hopi about the same time. We have other Alfred Whiting collections in the herbarium, but they're mostly just herbarium sheets of other species. So. And as I work with the corn collection, I kind of start wondering, just how many different kinds of corn are there? And that's a question that's really impossible to answer, because in the seed banks and things like that, they're duplicates. So there are many collections of the same variety or something like that. And kind of what happened in the old corn breeding days, which kind of still goes on, is each time a corn breeder developed a slightly different strain of corn, they would give it a new name and things like that. So it's really kind of impossible to know how many different kinds of corn there are, but this is at least how many different accessions they have at the Doomsday Vault in Svalbard. And I have, when I put this together, I have no idea why there are so many accessions for wheat, rice, and barley versus corn, which is a much smaller number. And I guess we're not going to have French fries after the zombie apocalypse, because there's almost no collections of root crops in the Doomsday Vault. Now, in germplasm banks where they do have samples of sweet potatoes and manioc and potatoes and things like that, stuff is all preserved by tissue culture. But it's not up in the Svalbard seed vault. And I kind of wondered, where is, where does the Svalbard stuff come from? So, probably even larger than the USDA collection is the collection down at CIMMYT, the Centro Internacional for Maíz de Maíz y Trigo, the Maize and Wheat Improvement Center. And they've contributed the largest number of things. A little bit has come from the Cherokee Nation, I think, is the only tribe so far that has put some of their seed in the seed vault, and they've donated material besides just maize, and some of their beans and squash varieties and things like that. Some of the heirloom companies like Seed Savers Exchange have donated some of the material. I know the founder of Seed Savers Exchange, who unfortunately passed away a while ago, was intending to get almost all of their collection into the Svalbard vault, but he and his wife got separated, and Kent lost custody of a lot of his documents and seeds and the divorce and things like that. So that was kind of a messy divorce. The Vavilov Research Institute in Russia, that's really probably the organization that got germplasm collection started. Nikolai Vavilov was a Russian plant breeder and geneticist and wheat breeder, and in the 20s and 30s he started sending teams out all over the world to collect as many different varieties of the cultivated plants as he could find, and their wild relatives. And there's a chapter of Plants, Man, and Life on called Science and the Bureaucrats and stuff, because Vavilov kind of ran afoul of Stalin's Minister of Science for promoting the wrong evolutionary theory. Lysenko, who was Stalin's science guy. He was a Lamarckian, and Valo said, "That's ridiculous and stuff like that." And Lysenko thought he could breed better wheat by exposing it to cold colder conditions and stuff. And Valo said, "No, you got to collect different varieties and crossbreed them and select and things like that." And unfortunately, Vavilov wound up in a gulag and passed away from typhus during the war. So that's, and this kind of raises a question. So this is People's Republic of Korea. They've sent 2,400 samples to the seed bank, whereas we've only sent half as many. So why is that? Okay, so why are a bunch of old corn cobs important? They've generated an awful lot of papers by Anderson Cutler Brown and other folks. They inspired the races of maize books. They're a record of crop diversity in one location at a point in time. A lot of the tribes today are trying to recover their traditional seeds that they lost when they were forced marched from Cherokee to Oklahoma or places like that, or as they moved west, they lost a lot of their traditional varieties of crops and things like that. So fortunately, our collection has examples of different kinds of corn grown by different tribes at different points of time. So they can use that as a reference for trying to find some of these other things. We sent germplasm up to the USDA. We're going to make this available to anyone all over the world via Tropicos with nice pictures of stuff. And we're going to do an exhibit on corn at the Sachs Museum in spring of 2024. Okay, so I'd just like to, thank a few people. Kim, who, kind of got me involved in this by hosting a bunch of luncheons over at Tower Grove Park, where I found out that the corn collection was back from Illinois. And then, Robbie showed up that day and said, "I'd love to see the corn collection." And so I started working with that. Jim Solomon, who brought the collection back from Illinois. Some of the folks I worked with in the past. He was a Zuni farmer who I worked with a bit back in 72 and 73 and collected my first, native corn. And then all the people who grew stuff in the collection. So